Let me tell you, there's so many voices in my head when someone told us about the idea that God wants to move us to a new location. And I got to be honest, all those voices saying, man, it's not going to work. But God is so faithful. Amen. I'm just so blessed that you guys are here with us. Hey, my name is Christian Leo. I am one of the pastors here. And today I get to share God's word with you guys. One of my favorite things. Now, before we start, I just want to say, let's give an applause, okay? Not just, but like a warm applause for all the people who has made today happen, who set up every single thing, who put their hearts and mind into all these things. Believe it or not, these things don't appear just by themselves. There are people who just put their hearts and mind into this. And so today did you see that? We want to make a proper introduction. I believe one of the best way we grow in Jesus is by serving. Because when we pour out instead of receiving, God starts working inside of us and at the same time make us a blessing to touch other people. And that's what Jesus called us to be. We are called to serve. So I'm glad God placed a group of people with different talents, with different giftings, and they are so talented. They're just so amazing. Today, I want to introduce you to some of these people. These are the people that have been leading our teams. They're the ones that have a vision about what a place, how to turn this place into a place that where we all could worship on Sunday. And a lot of you actually connected with us last week, and you filled up these cards, these white cards. I don't know if you've seen it. I'm just going to show you again. It's our hello cards. And a lot of you say, I want to get involved. And so you might be wondering, well, how am I going to get to do that? Well, that's why we're going to introduce them, so that you could chat more with them and get plugged in with our love crew. Can we show that? Oh, it's already here. All right. Well, we're going to call 4 reps today, and next week we're going to have 4 more reps. But I just want to introduce them real quick, have them share their hearts. Why does this thing matter? And I think they're also very excited about it. So can I have my 4 reps come up? Here we go. Where's my 4 reps? There you go. We got Andy. We got Susan. We got Beavis. We got Tanya. Hey, stand right here, man. Thank you, Pastor Mike. We got another mic right here. And so, ladies, can stand right here. This is Susan. Everyone say hi to Susan. If you don't know, Susan leads one of the rep for our ABBA Kids team, and they're doing such an amazing job. And so I'm just going to have Susan share the heart behind ABBA Kids and why should they get involved, right? That's the question today. So here we go. We're going to have her share about that. Here we go. I am going to give him some space right here. Just right here. Yeah.
No, seriously, all the kids, you gotta work with the kids.
That's right.
So that's the fun part. Because every time you're with the kids, they just bring that joy, that life, and it's just a blessing. I mean, I've seen kids actually who are all grown up, who are actually in the adult service now, and I used to be with them since they were 3-4 years old. And to see them all grown up and just, it's amazing. It's amazing. So the heartbeat behind ABBA Kids, I believe that we're raising the next generation.
There you go.
I mean, come on. The kids are the future. So, I mean, to be able to be involved in their lives, to sow seeds, to bring them to Christ is amazing. So that's a heartbeat of ABBA Kids. And why I do what I do? I think you know why I do what I do. So join us. We would love for you to be a part of ABBA Kids.
Thank you, Susan. She's preaching. I think I'm going to go home. She did my part. Here we go. Andy, what crew are you with?
I'm with the production team. I'm with the production team. My name is Andy. We're behind the scenes, so I think we're perfect for those who cannot wake up early. You don't have to brush your teeth. You don't have to shower. You don't have to put on makeup as long as... No, I have to correct myself. Brush your teeth because I'm going to be sitting next to you. We're a team base, so at least odor-wise, got to have it in check. But yeah, we're production team. I always see ourselves as we're the hand and the feet and the sweat of God in making things look nice. Because, you know, we don't want to leave arts and creativity and design only in the secular world. And we come here and you know, it's like, what is it like? God give us passion and creativity and all of these things that's in our mind, and we just have to be able to express it.
That's
and
good,
we
man.
Are the one who makes it happen. Later on, Beavis is going to introduce the creative team, but we're the production team. We're the one who make it happen. We're the one who...
Oh, did you see that?
I'm not saying we're you know, we're...
Pull the carpet out.
No, in a good way. We need to work together. They came up with the design, and we're the one who work with them to make it, you know, to display it, to you know, just to display. And also, I think my passion is always like to break down that sometimes we compartmentalize God and only like I'm giving my best only at church. Like when I'm serving, I'm giving my best. But I work full time as a programmer. My passion is always to bring whatever I got from the church, the values that God gave me, the Holy Spirit that God gave me, I bring it to work. And then whatever I learn from work, I bring it to our ministry. So God is, I mean, Jesus is always with us. It's not like he's with us when we're doing ministry or when, you know, but when we're going to work, all right, God, I'm going to work. But it's, so my passion is always to, Jesus is always with us.
That's good.
And then let's let him work through us wherever we are, when we're in a production team or when we're at work. But yeah, let's him use us. Thank you.
Amen. So Jesus called us to be programmers of men. Here we go, Andy. This is Beavis, everybody. Give a clap for Beavis.
I don't want to be biased, but I believe Creative Crew is the best crew.
Yeah, man.
Actually, it's going to be our very first in Abel of history to have this team built up, and we know how much we need it, from the countdown all the way to testimonials. What we're doing is we're telling stories of what God has been doing around our community to display it in front of everyone to see.
Go, come up a little bit, man. There you go, right here.
So if you have the gift in videography, in photography, in graphic design, any type of design, we want you in our crew, because Creative Crew, best crew.
There you go. Right. Thank you, Beavis. Everybody, give it up for Tanya!
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
So I'm going to start off with a verse, because we're at church.
Okay, everyone's going this way.
Okay, so in Galatians 6:10, it says, "So then, as we have the opportunity, let us do good to everyone, especially to those who are the household of faith." So in the welcoming crew, you are doing firsthand what God has told you to do, to serve others. Okay, so...
Oh, it has a PowerPoint going on in the background. Look at that.
If you have the heart to serve others, then you are coming into the right ministry. We are the face of the church. You are the first faces that you see when you come in, right? Okay, so, and if you... Okay, so let's be real here. So if you're like me, who have very little musical talent, technology does not agree with you. And children are overwhelming.
Oh.
Really, all you need is a serving heart and a smile to be in my crew.
Man, come on. Give it up. Thank you, everybody. You might be seated. I know. No more. You guys are sitting down. Ruining my sermon. Thank you very much for all the love. A little healthy competition is good, amen. Hey guys, we just want to encourage you to get plugged in, get involved, serve. They're going to be standing up outside. You can't miss it. There's a giant board that says Love Crew. And so talk to them. Next week, we're going to open a sign up. 4 more people, 4 more reps are going to come up next week. And so just stay there. Think about what God wants to do through you. Because I believe all of us have a place, because this is home. Amen. So,
I don't know where to start now because they're all like throwing verses and everything. But I believe that God is just doing some cool things in the community. You know, here's the truth. We talk a lot about the church as Rose. I think Jordan mentioned an announcement. But I don't think we talk enough about the church as being circles. In reality, the shape of the church matters so much because the image that you have of the church, whoa. Okay, that happened twice to me. The image that you have of the church will determine your expectations of the church. It will determine what you want to get out of the church and also how you practice church. And that's the reality of it. And so today we want to talk about the shape of the church because actually circles are way better than rows. All right? Nothing wrong with this, but circles are way better than rows. We're in a series called Love Out Loud. Today, we're launching a 7 days devotional for you. You can go to ibelovedchurch.com, drop down menu, devotionals, or read, and you can find, starting tomorrow morning, we're all gonna be reading about the same thing, about the church. How can the church love out loud? I want you to read it together, and when you read, share. You can actually post on the website, or you can text it to someone else, share it on Facebook, talk to someone about it. This is the Love Out Loud devotional. But like I said, circles are better than rows. That's what I want to talk about today. We find ourselves in a very similar situation as the early church. You know, one time, the early church, after Jesus went up, they were scared. They were gathered in this small little room, and they're thinking, man, now Jesus is already with the Father. What am I going to do here? We're a little tiny group. We don't know what we're going to happen to us. But suddenly, the Holy Spirit come upon them, empower them. And suddenly, there's a lot of courage coming up, faith coming up. And then Peter, he stepped out of that little room and standing with the other 11 apostles, and he preached one of the best messages that he preached ever. And that day, 3,000 people decided to follow Jesus. Isn't that awesome? Well, there's not 3,000 people here. But at our grand opening, it was close. And when there's so many people, some of you came and you heard Pastor Mike preach that inspired word. And you heard that the Father loves you no matter who you are. God loves you the way you are. And he's calling you not to stay where you are, but to move with him. Something speaks inside of your heart and your heart starts burning. And you say, just like these people in the early church, they ask Peter, they said, what do we do? You know, believe it or not, what made the early church love so loud is not that grand opening. It was the thing that they did afterwards. You want to learn together what it is? Let's read it. Here it is, Acts chapter 2. If you have your Bible, you can open it. If not, we're going to read it together up there. You ready? You don't have to read it. I'll read it for you. 1, 2, 3. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. Get this. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Some of them sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. And every day, say every day. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all people. And the Lord added daily to their number those who were being. How many were added? That was not my question. How many were added? Many. Someone said daily. Many. How did it happen? Daily. Believe it or not, the early church didn't grow only from rows. They grew from circles. If you want to know what kind of church the early church is, you ask the word on the street. And this was the word on the street. One of our mentors says, if you want to know how impactful your church has been, go to the closest 7-Eleven and ask the guy, hey, what do you think about that church? And if he says, what church? If he says, what church? You have not done your job. Convicted me, made me think, what is really the church? The early church is known for their community life. They live life in circles. They have a different view of church than what our culture knows as it. This is what we know. This is the church. Yes, you guys are all gathering here and we're saying like, here's Abba Love Church. But Abba Love Church doesn't only happen in rows. It happens in circles. They live out their lives amazingly. Generosity, love in action, healings and miracles took place. What a supernatural life. And they are devoted. A word that is so hard these days to find. In a marriage relationship, in a boyfriend-girlfriend relationship, or in a church setting. Because we don't understand that to grow, we need to be planted. That to grow, we need to commit. That to grow, we need to be devoted. Some of you said, I've taken steps towards Jesus. I've heard about him. I actually already prayed the prayer. That's great. But what God is calling you to do is this. Would you devote your life? What does that look like? You don't have to be a pastor like Mike. You don't have to be a pastor like me. You can be a programmer like Andy. But you follow Jesus. You could be a teacher that loves Jesus. And Jesus just coming out of you, and the kids that you teach, they feel the love of Jesus every time they meet with you. That is the love God has for us. But to do that, we need to circle up. The early church, they circled up in homes, in workplaces, in marketplaces. Oh man, God loves circles so much. People were getting saved every day. Look, if the church happened here only Sunday, can we experience what the Bible is talking about? No, absolutely not. How are we going to see people coming to Jesus daily if the church is only rows and not circles? The church is a circle because God is a circle. Are you ready? Why is God creating us for this circle of life? Here it is. Because our circle is the place of healing. Circles speak of one anotherness. This is the lifestyle of Jesus. There are 59 one another in the Bible. How are we going to practice it in rows? You cannot practice the 59 one another commandments in rows. Carry each other's burden. Forget it. We don't even know what is the burden of the person next to us right now. Give your neighbor a smile. See, that doesn't mean anything. That's just a smile. A smile can mean I'm actually struggling really badly inside. A smile doesn't tell you, oh, this person's so happy. We all hide behind smiles. Pastor Mike showed the LOL emoji. I was cracking up the back because that's what I always send to my wife. Cracks up, but we're not really feeling that way many times, right? And so God wants us to love out loud, not in rows, but in circles. Forgive one another. How are you going to forgive one another? We don't even know one another. We got to get to know one another. Pray for one another. That's great. I'm going to be praying for you at the end of the service. You don't get to pray for me. One another means I get to do something for you and you get to give it back. Only in circles you will find that. Serve one another. Love one another. I'll tell you about our Friday night group. This Friday was insane. I don't know what happened, man. But I know one thing. Circles are truly places of healing. We literally made a circle. No, we literally made a circle. And we asked one of the person, our friend, that had been baptized recently, and we say, can you sit in the middle of the circle? And she's like, what are you going to do? I promise we won't do anything creepy. We just want pray for you. She was there in the middle of the circle. Here's what I learned about circles. Circles are powerful because God goes around the circle. And so one person starts saying specific words that I don't know how to explain it. Specific words. Holy Spirit was just speaking, and she started crying because she said, how do you know? How do you know that? How can God know that? Specific words, things of the past, the brokenness. And sometimes when we hear about these things, we say, how's that possible for God to move like that? Oh man, God, he has been waiting. He can't wait to embrace you. Remember the Father? Remember the Father in the story that Pastor Mike shared last week? He was just waiting, man. And that's what I saw. But I learned something about circles, especially if you are a control freak like me. We don't like circles. We like rows because I'm in control. One day, I was so frustrated at my group. This happened a long time ago with the garage. I just said, God, I feel like we should grow more. We should be more excited about Jesus. God, I read the book of Acts. Man, I want to find a church like that. God says, go find it. If you can find it, I'll give you a candy. No, he didn't say that. He says, you could try finding it, but you won't find it. You will never find the place that you imagine because you need to build it. And so I said, all right, I'm going to build it. And I'm sharing, and I feel like I'm giving out a lot, and I felt burned out. Sometimes when you give, it feels like other people are not giving back to you, and we get disappointed, and we shut down, and we just say, no, I'm not going to live this circle life anymore. It's too pricey. It's too messy. I get to see people in real life. Oh, we want a fake life? Of course, real life. But we can't handle the consequences sometimes. And so I said, God, I don't know what to do. I feel like I'm doing everything. Anyone ever felt like that? I'm doing everything. So God says, okay, if you're doing too much, don't do anything. I said, what do you want me to do? Go to group. Don't speak a word. You can ask the people that were there. I came. I sat down. And here's what happened. All eyes on me. I say, Christian, I said, guys, today, I just want to be here. And they said, okay, what are we going to do? We're so used to you talking so much and praying for everyone and doing everything. And that's when I went home. Guess what? That was the worst meeting that I felt like I was in it. I felt like, man, God, really? But as I was walking, God spoke and he says, that's your fault. You talk too much. Anyone talk too much like me? Here's the word. A word from me to you. An advice. Stop talking too much. In circles, you let other people talk. Those of you who are afraid to talk because you're like, I got no beautiful words for a prayer. My prayer is, Jesus, you hear me. That's it. That's fine. Speak up. Because God wants to use you. And only then, in circles, Jesus will be expressed in full. That's what a real relationship looks like. It's messy, but it's worth it. Number two, why God loves circles so much? Because our circle is the source of power. You hear it, you heard it before. There's strength in numbers. Spiritually, it is true because the kingdom of God advances through agreement and unity. When I agree with myself, there's no power. You don't pray and say, I agree with myself. You have to agree with another person. That's why Jesus says, when 2-3 people gather in my name, I will be there and I will work and I will move because it takes at least two. Imagine a circle. Get ready for a powerful night. That's why I love worshiping here with you guys. But I love it more when we're sitting down in circles. Because it's amazing. Don't believe me? Let's read the Bible. Ecclesiastes 4:9-10. Let's read it together. One, two, three. Two are better than one because they have a good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up. But pity anyone who falls and has no one to help them up. Biblical principle. If you feel that you're falling down and you feel like you're by yourself, you need a circle. No, I never seen anyone who come to church by themselves. Right? They read the advertisement by themselves, like, oh, I'm going to go to this church, it's awesome. Entered into the church, sit by himself, right? Serve coffee for himself. Try to connect by himself. Listen to the sermon by himself. Responded by himself. Not only that, he prayed for himself. In Jesus' name, I need healing today. And then he go back home, he went to the bathtub, baptized himself. Go back out. Oh man, I'm a follower of Jesus now. Every morning, look at the mirror, encouraging himself. Come on, man. I never seen anyone like that because it doesn't work that way. You need at least two because God created us to be a circle. Here's why God loves circle. And my third point, our circle is God's dwelling place. Whoa. We don't want God to be just present. We want God to dwell. You know the difference between the two? Present means this. God, come here. Holy Spirit, you are well. Come here in rows. And we look at each other. Say, bye, man. See you next week. High five. Abba love. And we go our own way and we live our own life and we're walking individually. And then the next week we come again. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. And we leave again. And God says, dude, I'm not a hotel guest. I'm not interested in being present. I'm interested in living among you. I'm interested in always being inside of you. And that's why if Jesus lives inside of you, your life will never be the same. You are not only baptized into repentance and salvation, you are baptized into a community. That's why we call ourselves the body of Jesus. Every part have different function. That's why you saw those teams that were up there, different functions, different gifts, different talents. But when they come together, even though they don't like each other too much, they love each other. They're just excited about their crew. But God could use that. This is a bloody realization that we are a circle. You know how I know? The first martyr in the Bible, his name is Stephen. He died for this one truth, that God dwells in circles and not in rows. You're saying, well, Christian, in America, no one's persecuting us. I know, I've watched the news, and some places, they ban Christianity. You can't follow Jesus openly. Who's persecuting us here? Who's persecuting the church? There is one spirit that persecutes the church, and it's called the spirit of religion. We all struggle with a religious spirit inside of us. And what happened was, when they grabbed Stephen, because Stephen kept on saying, God loves circles, and he wants to use the church. Jesus is real, and his power is just gonna explode through the circle. They captured him, and they put him on trial, all these religious leaders. And they asked him, and they said, are you not a Jew? What are you saying? You're saying this Jesus guy is building up a new circle, a new church. What are you talking about? We're going to stick in rows. But Stephen said this. He says, the Most High does not live in houses made by human hands. God doesn't live in the building, church. Come on. When you drive up the parking lot, how many of you go, you know, you look in the mirror and you kind of like, okay, I'm in church now. Church face on. We walk in, we say, hallelujah, hello, brother. How are you, man? We changed the lingo. You were like, what's up, brother? And then suddenly you walk into church like, oh, man, hallelujah, I love you, bro. Come on.
Do we really believe that God dwells in this physical building? That's a problem. We have a wrong church mindset, and we think that God dwells here. God doesn't dwell here. He dwells in circles. And so you should be more concerned about your everyday life than when you walk in here. I fought with my wife on the way to church once. Actually, many times. We were late. I was like, come on, babe, we're late. He said, well, I'm not done yet. Well, I am late. How many of you fought with your spouses for going to church? Hey, confession time. Awesome. Openness is the key to healing, brother. But I'll tell you this. We're fighting. Go to 15 freeway. Fighting. 60 freeway. Fighting. 75. Fighting. Parking lot. We're not going to talk about this. We're going to go in. And you're going to say hi to everybody. And I'm going to put a smile on my face. Because I have to serve Jesus. How come you guys excited when your pastor confessed their sin? Come on. But that's the reality. We idolize man-made buildings and we think God dwells here. God lives in circles, guys. God doesn't live in just rows. We need to repent. We need to say, God, I need the fear of the Lord every day, not just today. When we do that, and we gather in circles, when 2-3 people gather in His name, God live among you. So Jesus, He wants that kind of church. Living, breathing, moving church. Yeah? Are you guys getting this? Well, I want to invite a couple of my close friends. His name is Jordan and Jessica. Come up, guys. We love putting people on stage because this is the faces of our community. And sometimes when we don't hear real stories, the word of God sometimes just kind of go, right? And so they shared a little bit with us how God changed them through living in circles. So I'm just going to ask you guys to share what God did in your life. Go ahead, man. Your floor.
I'm Jordan. This is my beautiful wife, Jessica.
Did you guys have an argument on the way here?
We drove separately.
Oh, you drove? Oh! Yeah. That's what I should have done.
My husband let me sleep in.
Yeah,
that's nice. True. That's really nice.
So, my testimony, my first memory, actually, is accepting Jesus with my mom when I was 2 or 3. And I was raised in a Christian home. And my parents taught me to love Jesus. I was raised right. I went to church. I was in the Bible studies. I was in the circles. We went on mission trips. And, you know, Jesus was my identity. And I was by no means perfect. I had many, many struggles. But I had never lost my faith until we actually moved down here for me to go to graduate school. Graduate school was a lot of work. I'm still in it. I'm in my fifth year. And I was putting in 80-hour weeks, and we were trying to go to church. We weren't involved in a Bible study. And what happened is that these doubts and these questions started coming into my mind, and I couldn't answer them on my own. I didn't have answers. And over time, they took over to the point where I didn't even know if I believed in God anymore. Like that, I remember being in a parking lot and just the hopelessness that I felt. What's my purpose, right? I was lost, and my identity had been lost too. And that's where I was at until God brought us back into community.
So, all right, Jess.
Wait, sorry. Oh, that was really loud. So Jessica's story is just a little bit different.
Thank you for that segue. Yeah, okay.
You changed it on me. My story is a little bit different than Jordan's, since looking at me.
You can't speak by looking that way.
Sorry. So I grew up in a house where God was, like, talked about, and we went to church, and it was very evident that my mom put a high esteem on going to church on Sundays. So that was kind of my experience of church. So I believed in a God. I knew that he would always be there to protect me and everything. I went to college, and in high school, I guess I was pretty good. I made sure I got good grades, not because my mom was Asian and told me I had to get A+, but because I put that expectation on myself. So, but she also wouldn't let me hang out with anybody except for band geeks, because they were good and innocent and I couldn't get in trouble. So then I fought a lot with my mom. I ended up going to Santa Barbara, UC Santa Barbara, which is where we met. And you know, UCSB has a reputation of, you're all nodding because you know. And I went to UCSB, it's a party school, Christian. So I went to school thinking, you know, I'm not gonna get caught up in that because I'm better than that or whatever. Well, it turns out I was more worried about wanting to feel like I had, like, I wanted to fit in. And because that was the main thing UCSB did, of course, I sought for a community, I guess, but in the wrong places. I ended up joining a sorority. So, you know what that means. But I wasn't just a party girl, I was like the party girl. Like, I had built up this reputation of myself that was just so not me, and it became me. I found my identity in fulfilling myself in these, being crazy, and everybody loved me because I was crazy, but I started realizing that they only knew me because of what I was using or what I was intoxicated with or whatever. That was the Jessica they knew. And so I built that relationship for myself, and thinking, oh, this is great. Like, I have everything I've ever wanted. I have friends. I wasn't really talking to my family. They thought I had lost it, and I didn't care. All I wanted was to be accepted. And if partying is what it meant, then I did that. And so I was dating a guy at the time before Jordan, and it literally got to a point where I was like, I don't need God because I just need this guy to like me. And I found my identity in men and doing all that stuff. So finally got to a point where God was like, well, you're going to do this. What happens if you're disappointed? And soon enough, I made this guy my everything. I was ready to give up Christmas. Come on, Christmas. Christmas, like, God, I was willing to say, I don't need any of that. He was Jewish. I whispered that. It's okay. But anyways, I met Jesus finally when I hit rock bottom. All the girls in my sorority who said that we were everlasting sisterhood, they all backstabbed me, and I ended up breaking up with that guy because he did other things that were more important than me, and I felt like I couldn't be loved for who I was, and that's all I ever wanted. So I finally met Jesus, and he spoke to me through a song, and it was J.J. Heller's Love Me, and in the song it says, I will love you for you no matter what who you've been, who you're going to be, and that's all I've ever wanted my entire life. So I met Jordan because my friend introduced us, and little did I know that I would be marrying my best friend. And we met at church. And Jordan actually, or God showed through Jordan that I was lovable for who I was, and the weirdness and the like randomness that I am. And then, so we got married. We were in good community in Santa Barbara, and then God made us change everything when I had to move back home to my mom's house. And I did not want to be home with my mom. And Sorry I put you through that, but it was kind of Jordan's choice, so he made me. But I realized that it was because I had things with my family that I needed to deal with and healing. But at that time, we weren't in community, and so it caused like a divide in our marriage, and to a point where I was seeking for guidance and leading, like, because a man's supposed to lead family, he wasn't giving that to me. And I know it was because of school, and he's super dedicated to school, but I needed more. And I would go and I would try to go to churches and find that elsewhere, even in other men, guys, like, not cool, that's what I said, as friends and community. And it was an unhealthy church that I was in, and I knew that I wasn't growing, but apparently, he brought it up last night. I even threatened to leave Jordan because he was so like far away from God. He told me that he was done. Like, he just, and for me, that was a breaking point, because I'm sorry. I honestly was like, I don't know if I can be with you if you're not going to believe the same thing as me. And so I kept pushing him. I would push him, maybe not in the most encouraging way, to go, like, you need friends, you need to get off your games, and you need to go meet people, talk to people. And I guess I was kind of mean. but then we met Mike and Mira, so after 3-4 years of living here, and Mike and Mira. Oh, sorry.
So my biggest excuse for every Bible study was, I'm too busy. I'm working an 80-hour work week sometimes. I have a paper due. I have a presentation next week. I have a final coming up. I don't have time to go to a Bible study. And all the Bible studies meet at 6:30. Like, you think I can get home at 6:30? I'm commuting an hour away. And then we meet these guys. And the first time I'm explaining this to Mike, he's like, dude, we'll start at 9 o'clock. What time do you get home? You want to come at 10? We'll do it at 10. Come on out. That I showed up to cell group at 10 o'clock at night. And yeah, praise God. Like, they welcomed me in, and the love that was shared that we felt, it was tangible. Now, who does that, right? And I had no excuse. They were willing to change stuff so that I would go. And that just drew us in. And even with that, it wasn't always easy for us to get there. We had weird sicknesses. I'd be at work and I'd be like, I have to do this experiment. And like, just everything would always get in the way. One of the times when we were about to go, I was cleaning something and I sliced my thumb almost to the bone. And it was bad, yeah. Like, we just kept having things, but we kept just pushing through. And eventually we got there. And God started to do a work in our lives. And one of those times, one vivid night that stands out, we got to sell, and we actually made it on time, praise God. No, it's at 8. And we got there for worship. And for me, I had all these deadlines. It's nonstop in my mind. What's the next step? What's the experiment that I'm gonna do? This work was my number one priority, and that was destroying our marriage, right? And when I got there and we're worshiping, I felt this peace. And the deadlines didn't matter. And I felt God speaking to me. And this peace was like, I don't know, like I was water, right? And there was constantly stones being thrown in, and suddenly there's this calm. And that's how I felt during worship that night, because God was really tangible there.
For me, when we started the worship session, like, for me, music speaks so loudly. Not literally because it's loud. I mean, it is. But God speaks to me through music, and I just, like, appreciate that we do that before every Bible study. I've been in Bible studies before, but music is what gets me. So something cool happened. Mike asked.
Okay. So we entered into a sharing time. You know, God's speaking to us. He wants to speak to all of us. So we were sitting down in a circle, and Pastor Mike's like, all right, let's start with Jordan. And you know, God had been speaking to me, and he kind of put on my heart, because I was struggling with all this doubt. And what God was saying to me, your doubt's okay. Even when Jesus ascended into the heaven, it says in the Bible that the disciples still doubted. They just watched Jesus go up in heaven. So he was saying to me, your doubt is okay, but you need to follow me again. And reminded of Revelation 2, when Jesus spoke to the church in Ephesus, and he says, your good works are okay, you're working hard, but you need to return to your first love. You need to love others. And that's what God was speaking to me. And then Jessica was next. She can share.
Can you hear me anyway? So for me, I've kind of been struggling in like, oh, I can't hear God. And that's just things that I need to work on. But what I did feel at that moment, I was just super grateful for like the cell group and how they've helped us with moving and just how they've welcomed us with open arms. So I just wanted to say thank you personally to each person. And everyone says that was just like me encouraging people, and obviously I started to cry, like I'm crying now and all the time. And then Mike said, all right, we need to pray for her, as soon as I started to cry. And then something interesting happened, and I don't know how to explain it. Kind of like what Christian was saying with that girl that they prayed over, they did the same to me. I'm sitting in the little chair, the Mika's like little baby chair, and my butt's hurting, and I'm like stuck in there. So all of a sudden, people just started coming up to me, praying prophetically over me, and it was things that were being revealed, like nobody knew who I was yet. And it was things that, there are things that I couldn't even describe that I was feeling, that I was dealing with, and they were just lifting it to the surface and bringing it to God. And I had Felicia and Rico. Are they even here? Oh, hi, Dad. I mean, sorry. I call him Dad because he reminds me of my dad. and so they were just praying over me, like as presenting my mom and dad, because there's a lot of pain there, my parents. And so I just realized that in this community, they're going to help me with healing and forgiving my family and things that have happened. And so that night, all we did was cry. And when we went home, Jordan and I were like, what just happened? We were so overwhelmed. They're praying for things that we didn't share at all with family, our marriage, and then babies. Because I want more than anything a baby. And we were just so overwhelmed with your love and God's love. And we didn't know what to do with ourselves. So then we decided, you know, we're just going to get plugged in, and we're going to do the best we can to serve. And I just love you guys a lot. And we want to encourage you to start, thank you, get plugged in, because church is awesome, you know, in rows. But in circles, it's even better. And you will be overwhelmed. And I just want to say I have my girls here today. They're my core, Vanessa and Susanna. And they've been with me since I moved down here. And I want you guys to experience what I've experienced. And I want to thank Jordan, because he's really stepped it up, like from, he's just, he's on fire, guys. Yeah. I'm done. I can't do this anymore.
All right, give one more round of applause, guys. Thank you. Thank you so much, Jordan.
Yeah, there you go, man.
I mean, I saw they weren't praying over me, but for me to be there with all my doubts, but to see prophetic prayer, specific words spoken over her life, those doubts were gone. This is the power of God made manifest in our lives. And that's, for me, it became real. in that moment. It was God's love overflowing into our lives because he's reaching out. That's what prophecy, prophetic word is for. It's God reaching out to speak love into your life, to call us home. And that's, we find home not only in rows, but definitely in circles. So definitely plug in.
Made my job easier. That was it. I mean, that's Jesus speaking through the body of Christ. Amen. I love it. Hey, I'm going to leave you guys with two challenges today. First of all, join a group. If you're not in one, we got groups all over the places, man. We got one in San Gabriel area. We got one in Rancho area. We got Chino Hills area. We got one, we got some in schools. Come on, college students. Whoop, whoop. We're going to circle up everywhere, man. And we're going to see Jesus just be Jesus. Amen? That's the first one. If you want to join a group, easy. Go to our website or talk to one of us. If you're choosing to do the first one or go to our website, there is a drop-down menu and it says groups. You can't miss it. So you press that and you can actually see all the groups that are meeting up and the schedules that are going on. We're continuously updating it because we have new groups added. We're just so excited about people living in circles. And you can press one of the group and you can write your name and your contact info and an email going to be sent to the cell group leader and they'll contact you. That's as easy as it gets. If you want it easier, just come talk to us. All right? But we want you to plug into groups. Second thing that I want to challenge you. We are part of a tribe of people that believe church life is in circles, and we believe that the body of Christ is called to a higher purpose than just rows. And this tribe of people are going to have a meetup, and it's called the Group Life Conference. Me and Pastor Mike, we're going to be holding workshops there and modeling cell groups and all these things, and you guys got to get part of that. But I want to challenge you. If you say, man, I've been in church my whole life and I've never understood this circle thing. I want to learn more. This is a place to go. It's only, I believe, $29 and you get food, and it's October 14 to 16. So I'm going to show you a video and I'll talk a little bit about more about that. So if we can hit the lights and get that video on.
There are some things that once they've been seen, you just can't unsee them. And there are some things that once you've experienced them, you just can't unexperience them. For years now, the church has been struggling to find her voice and her place within culture. And we can blame it on politics, we can blame it on a changing cultural landscape, but the fact of the matter is, if we believe in a God who is passionately pursuing humanity with his love, with all of his purpose and power, then there should be nothing that could stand against him in this movement known as the church. And yet we still struggle with how do we transform a world around us with love. At the same time, the church around the globe is thriving in the most unexpected of places. I mean, if you look at what's going on in China, in Ukraine, in Latin America, and around the globe, we're seeing people who are coming together in community, who are experiencing the power and presence of Jesus, not just in church buildings, but at their homes, at their workplaces, at their schools, who are experiencing what happens when people come together in the power and the presence of Jesus to transform the world. We are committed to bringing a tribe of people together who are committed to experiencing the power and presence of Jesus in the context of community. Not only on Sunday mornings, but at their homes, in their workplaces, at their schools. A tribe of people who are crazy enough to believe that when we come together with the purpose of being the body of Christ, we might actually see the world transform and love expand all around us. On October 14th and 15th, we're hosting the very first Group Life Conference here in Pomona, California. We're having thought leaders come in from all over, Ralph Naber Jr., Randall Naber, Neil Cole, and a slew of other individuals who are experiencing and practicing what it looks like to live life together in the context of community. And are you seeing that community transform the world around them? If you're committed to moving forward on your spiritual journey, if you're committed to the movement of Jesus and expanding it, if you're committed to seeing lives transform with love, then this is for you. Sign up today at thegrouplife.com.
I love that. Thegrouplife.com. Again, Group Life Conference. We're all invited. We're a partnering church with Mosaic Pomona. That was Pastor Nathan Naber. Actually, he's going to be speaking here next month, and so we're excited for that. But we're partnering with other churches who believe in a tribe of people who lives in circles, not just in rows. Can we do that? So we'll do those two things. Plug into groups. If you want to check out more, outside there's a booth and with a laptop, and our website's going to be on it. You can check out all the groups there. If you want to sign up right there and there, you could do that. By the way, if you see me wearing clothes and there's some people wearing some sheeps, I want to share with you our partner in ministry. This is One Found Sheep. One Found Sheep is a nonprofit. It's a movement of young people who are excited about sharing their God stories with others. And the way you do that is that by wearing these sheep clothes, and people ask you, is that a pig? Is that a fat sheep? What is that? And we go, well, here's the thing. I was once lost as a sheep, but Jesus found me. I'm a one found sheep. And you tell your story, and you get to share with them how the church wants to take the Great Commission seriously about making disciples and finding other lost sheep. So talk to my buddy Jordan. He's a part of our small groups. He's going to be out there. He has some sheep clothes. If you want to talk more about it, learn about the movement, what are we doing? We're partnering together. We believe that God called us to make disciples in our beloved. Amen. I'm just going to pray for us. And our ministry reps, all the crew reps, I'm going to invite you to just stand outside in a common room, and you guys get to talk with them, and I'm just going to dismiss you. So let's pray. Yeah? Let's pray. Well, let's stand up. Let's pray together. That's good.